appreciate you, Lord, from the depths of my heart. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us, Lord. Most of all, I'm thankful, Lord, that one day you reached down, Lord, into my heart and my life. Lord, when I was lost and undone without you, Lord. God, and you miraculously, Lord, you miraculously filled me with the Holy Ghost, Lord. God, I'm so thankful tonight. I'm blessed, Lord, beyond measure tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise tonight. Hallelujah, Lord, we love and appreciate you. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. Amen, amen. Thank you, Lord. Y'all get it in the key that you sang me. I was still having trouble with this on the drum of mine or whatever this is.
I'm
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I'd like to do something. Everybody listen. I want to get real quiet. Now then. Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. There ain't going stone. There ain't no stone going to take my place.
Hallelujah.
Now, a lot of people like to go to church, and they may like it quiet. But I didn't like it when it was quiet. Woo! Amen. I like it when I go when people are praising the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. When there's a noise going on, a joyful noise going on. Hallelujah. Worshiping the Lord. Hallelujah. But I don't want no stone to take my place. Hallelujah. I want to lift him up. I want to give him praise. Hallelujah. Because he's worthy. Amen. Where would I be tonight if it hadn't been for Jesus? Amen. Hallelujah. Isn't it good? Amen. He's a good God tonight. Amen. It's so good. Hallelujah. To have Brother and Sister Seymour and Sister Christina back. Amen. And from their vacation. And Brother Seymour said they had a good time. And that's what it's all about. Going and seeing. Amen. God's creation. Just enjoying. And he did tell me he got that lobster. So. Yeah. Hallelujah. Amen. That's good. That's good. Hallelujah. Well, hey, sometimes you just got to, as the old saying is, you just got to bite the bullet and do it, you know. Hallelujah. Amen. But we're so thankful that the Lord's blessings was up on them. Amen. Give them a good time without no trouble or anything. Amen. I know Sister Christina put a picture on there. It's a beautiful. Amen. Beautiful area that they was in, and it's so good. I love fall years. Really, my time of the year. I love it when the leaves start turning colors and the beauty. Amen. And it's just one of my favorite times of the year. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Someone that loves the Lord tonight, you got a testimony. Amen. You got. A praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Why don't you stand up and do it. Amen. Sister Nancy.
I want to thank the Lord for this evening. I still want to praise him for what he did for me. And he's so great. And I want to thank him for the wonderful Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
I don't want no stone to take my place. No.
That's right.
They
That's
said
right.
that one night. And I hadn't been playing my tambourine for a while. And I came over here and got it. And I said, I love God tonight, not
praise. Yes, amen. Somebody else right quick. Amen. You love the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Bless us, Seymour. You didn't do like I've seen in pictures, Brother Vic. Put one ladder up to the lower limb, then got another ladder, set it on that limb, and went up to another limb, then set another ladder, and went on up.
I trust the Lord.
Hallelujah. Amen. One ladder's enough, isn't it? Amen. Someone else, right quick, got a testimony tonight. It's good to have Lynn with us tonight. Here she's had a little improvement, amen, in her life. We're thankful for that. Hallelujah. We're just asking the Lord to, amen, just do what needs to be done in her heart and life. Amen. Both spiritually and physically. Amen. Hallelujah. Someone else right quick. You got a testimony.
I thank God for the Holy Ghost.
Come on, Brother Jeremy.
I thank Him for all His many blessings. Thank Him for our health.
Yeah.
Thank Him for my job.
Yes.
He's been good to me.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Thank
Sister
you.
Christina, you got a song?
No, I was just about
all right. Hallelujah.
Yeah, I thank God for keeping His hand upon us and that break like 4 or 5 months ago on this trip. Flights, because I was nervous. Flights would be so nervous. Lord, we just let's have a good pilot. Let's have a good flight. There's been no turbulence much and a good landing. I prayed for all this stuff like 4 or 5 months ago.
Yeah.
And this is like the problem with the smoothest flights we were on.
Hallelujah.
And once when we landed, I didn't realize we'd even landed. It was that smooth. And I spread it up for all of them. We saw the, all the beauty and stuff. It's beautiful. I kayaked for the first time so on the lake. So we had a good time.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I like that. I like that verse of scripture. It says, "Lo, I am with you." Hallelujah. Amen. I'm not much on that flying. Hallelujah. I've done a little bit.
It says to the stars, He was there.
Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Brother Kevin, come say something right quick. Man, Brother Seymour, he's been gone now 3 services, so he may be long-winded tonight. Hallelujah. We're going. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Say something, bro.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm glad my pastor's back.
Thank you.
I didn't enjoy it while he was gone, though.
Thank you, Lord.
But I still love it when he comes back.
Yeah.
God's still the same God either time.
That's right, brother.
We didn't have no splits in the church while he was gone. We did have most of them sitting on this side, though.
One side.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
But God's good.
Yes, sir,
I was
brother.
Thinking today, and I ain't got a whole lot to say, but I was thinking today, I'm glad that I can get up in the morning and ask my Lord for help.
Yes, yes sir, brother.
I'm glad that I can rejoice every morning.
Yeah.
I'm glad that He is my help, my ever-present help in trouble.
Yes,
He is. He's always there.
Yeah.
I know sometimes it's easy when you get up in the morning if you don't already have the habit of doing it, which is good to have the habit of doing it. Don't have to have it. You can just get to going and forget all about starting it off right. And you can begin to see how bad the day begins to go without talking to the Lord first. Without getting His direction. Without settling in that path that He wants you to walk on.
Thank you.
If we ever do stray, we aren't much of a match for the devil on our own.
That's right, brother.
It's a good thing to get everything under the blood first thing.
Yes.
And get our minds stayed on Him. That's one of them scriptures that I like to keep in my mind. Keep my mind stayed on Thee.
Yes.
Thank you.
I wish somebody would sing that song. I don't got a clue how it goes, but he's always there to answer prayer. No, I can't think of it. But anyway,
he's on.
No, that's not it. I love y'all.
Amen. It'll come to him about 10 minutes from now. When something else is going on. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Somebody else right quick. Amen. You want to testify. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. It's your
opportunities. Amen. Anybody got a song you want to sing tonight? Sometimes I get up here and I, Brother Don, you want to sing? Or, you know, you want Sister Nancy, you want to sing? Or, you know, whatever. Sometimes, you know what, you may have a song and I may not call on you. Amen. But I'm here to tell you, amen, if you got a song, God has given you a song. That's right. Amen. Amen. There ain't nothing wrong with saying, hey, Brother Gunther, I got a song. The Lord's placed a song in my heart. Because you know what? That might be the key to the service of God, doing something. Hallelujah. Amen. Help us to be sensitive, amen, to the moving of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. All right. Amen. Come on, Brother Seymour. Everybody say, Lord bless Brother Seymour. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
I am glad to be in God's house. And I'm glad to be home. Didn't get to go to church while we were there, just kind of doing it on our own. Sitting on the front porch, reading the Bible on the cell phone, praying a little bit, ain't the same as being in church.
That's right. Tell you,
it's good to start your day out that way, but ain't nothing like being in the house of God. And I was thinking before church, you know, seems like nowadays there's something lost. You know, you know, older saints, man, it had to be something serious to keep you from church. You know, I remember times, you know, I've had vehicle problems. I've borrowed vehicles. I've called people to get rides. You know, I don't want to be a burden to somebody, but I want to be in the house of God. A couple of church sick. You know, and nowadays, it's, well, you don't need to do that, you're going to make everybody else sick. But I don't know how many times I've come to church sick and left well.
Well, yeah,
that's right. Because I come to church and I come and got prayer for that sickness, yeah. Like the Bible says. Elders of the church anointed me with oil and it was gone.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. I'm serving that kind of God, but I'm fearing that this generation isn't understanding it like we used to. You know, it's getting to be like a hobby to some folks. You can fit it into your lifestyle. God needs to be first.
That's right.
Thank you. We're talking about, you know, waking up in the morning. I woke up this morning, smile on my face, and thank you, Jesus. I love you. You know, and
yeah.
What a privilege.
That's right, brother.
You know, I just got out on the porch and I was reading my Bible and praying and just started thanking God for all the things He's given me. Little things, you know, that you don't even think about sometimes, but everything I've got, God gave me from the least little thing that's out in the yard to, you know, the whole house and everything else we've got. He's just so good. He's so good. And I was thankful to hear that Lynn, she texted us while we were on a trip, asked us how we were doing, come find out she didn't have no hope, heat, she's freezing, we're praying, Lord, help her, you know, get something. You know, so now she's over at her mom's house in Localville. He's got a shower, running water, got heat in the bathroom, indoors. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
It's blessings, now I'm telling you. A lot better living conditions. God's good to us.
Thank you, Jesus.
I pray for Lynn. I want to see God, you know, work things out in her life in the natural, but I want her to be able to understand in the spiritual where she needs to be with God.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God loves you.
Yes.
Hallelujah. He wants you. He wants you to be His child. Hallelujah. A close child.
That's right.
And I was thinking, you know, so many times, you know, when one of your kids comes running up to you and hugs you out of the loose, I love you, Mom. I love you, Dad. You know, how special that is. You know, do we neglect to do that to God sometimes? And that's not what I'm preaching on this evening. I just had those things on my mind. Praise God. I'm not going to try to sing. Hallelujah. But I am thankful to be back. I want to actually try to preach something I've preached before. But it's what I felt for tonight. The alternate route. You know, God's got a plan for our lives. whether we're in church or whether we're not in church, the day you were born, God had a plan for your life.
Uh-huh.
And if you'll yield to Him, God will allow that plan to take its effect.
That's right.
But the whole thing is, you've got to yield to Him. You've got a desire to go the route God wants your life to go. Hallelujah. It requires us to have a love for God. So I'm going to go to the book of Exodus chapter 13. If you like me, when I first started reading the Bible, I started out in Genesis and wanted to start reading different stories about God and the Bible and His children. And of course, then you got the Numbers, and I'm like, man, will I ever get through this? Wheelbarrow, we got wheelbarrow and all kinds of names I don't know how to pronounce. Praise God. But everything in the Word of God is there for a purpose. I've heard some good messages preached right out of Numbers. But I thank God for His many blessings. But this is Exodus chapter 13. I'll try not to ramble too much. And verse 17. And it came to pass, when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God led them not through the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest peradventure the people repent when they see war, and they return to Egypt. And you can be seen. You know, sometimes God takes our life on a one-way route. Hallelujah. We may think, man, there's a better route this way, there's a better route that way, but, you know, God's got a plan. And if we'll allow Him, He'll lead us on a one-way route. We're on a one-way trip, church. We're heading to heaven. Hallelujah. And sometimes on this journey, we can persuade God to let us have it our way.
Uh-huh.
Lord, I really don't want to do that. Lord, I don't really want to go that direction. Lord, come on, Lord, can I do something else? We sit there and complaining and griping to God until finally says, go ahead. Hallelujah. I don't want it like that. Hallelujah. I want to do it God's way. You know, I ask you now, before we even get started, what direction is your life headed? Ask ourselves that question. What direction is my life headed? Hallelujah. Headed in God's direction, God's route, or is my life headed in the way I want it to go? Hallelujah. Too many times, you know, I've seen in my life that I've got to the point to where I've kind of let go of some things and maybe wanted to enjoy some things in life that maybe I shouldn't have been going towards, and allowed myself to get myself going the wrong direction, maybe not the opposite direction, but not staying all the way in the middle of the path where I'm supposed to be. Hallelujah. And it doesn't turn out good. It doesn't turn out good. You know, an example of have it your way in 2 Kings chapter 20 and verse 1, another familiar story. In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death. And the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amoz, came to him and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. I'll tell you, that's a lesson for God to let you know ahead of time. Give you a chance to get your house in order, get everything right, make sure everything's where it needs to be before you go to meet him. But, verse 2 said, then he turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. Verse 4, and it came to pass, before Isaiah was gone out into the middle court, that the word of the Lord came to him, saying, and I skip down to verse 6, what he told Hezekiah, what the Lord said, and I will add unto thy days 15 years. And he said a little bit more there. But God heard his prayer. Hallelujah. And he gave him 15 more years. Now, you think of this, you know, nobody wants to die. You know, it's like the story about the pastor got up and said, who wants to go to heaven? And everybody raised their hand. One man, he said, asked him that first, how come you didn't raise your hand? He said, don't you want to go to heaven? He said, yeah, but I thought he was getting up a load tonight.
Yeah.
He wasn't wanting to die now. Hallelujah. But I've prayed again and again, Lord, if I'm going to go through my life and I'm going to get to the point to where I'm going to die lost, Lord, take me while I'm saved. I prayed that for my children, for my grandchildren. Lord, if I'm going to die lost, take me while I'm saved. And here, Hezekiah, I can't say he died lost, but boy, he sure did make a mess out of things by changing God's plans. Hallelujah. You know, the story goes that, well, let me just go ahead and read on down here. There's a danger when we detour from God's route.
Come on, brother.
You know, we read in the story that the messengers from Babylon came to visit him, the king of Babylon, and heard that he was sick, and he sent gifts unto him, you know, wishing him well. And he sent all these messengers, you know, to visit him, and then the prophet comes back and says, what'd you show him? I showed him everything in my house. There's not a treasure that I have that I didn't show him. And God gave him a rebuke and told him what was going to happen. How none of that stuff was going to be left. Everything he had, every single thing was going to be carried to Babylon. And he told him what was going to happen to his children after him. And his result was, I don't really understand it. He said, blessed is the word of the Lord, because there will be peace in my day. Man, I don't want to wish turmoil on my children. I don't want my children off in slavery. I don't want all kind of bad things happening to them. I'd rather have just went out then and let one of his children go ahead and take over as king, which is what happened, but then the Babylonians came. Hallelujah. But God's way is always the best. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what kind of troubles have come your way, maybe what's coming along in the future. But I'm telling you, if you know it's the will of God, you better yield to it. Hallelujah, no matter what it is. We've got to have that kind of faith in Him to know that, Lord, whatever you decide is best. He cares for us. He wants what's best for us. He wants us to make it to heaven to be with Him. Hallelujah.
That's right.
I look at the situation, I think, man, it's bad. We don't know the future, but God does. He knows the end from the beginning.
That's right.
You know, this road we're on, it has many detours. And we need God to keep us on the right path. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. There's a lot of enticements. There's a lot of things. You know, all the same sins still exist today that were back then. There's nothing new. We just got many, many more avenues to it today. The age of technology has made it, you know, possible for us to access things we never could have accessed before. Mm-hmm. Technology has put things in our minds that really never would have been there. I think of kids growing up, you know, on a farm. In the old days, there's no TVs and things like that in there. You know, they just get up and they work from can to can. They say, my, how that's so boring. And then I look around today and, how did anybody ever get by without a cell phone? Mm-hmm. You know, people pull them out for everything. I wonder why, you know, this plant is called that, or where this old adage come from. You just type it in there and you can get the answer on there somewhere. You know, there's all kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Working on a lawnmower. Man, I cannot figure out why this thing ain't getting fired. And you just type in troubleshooting such and such a lawnmower, and then it'll bring it up. Had a lawnmower one time, riding mower. I couldn't figure out what in the world, why it wasn't starting. It had gas, and, you know. Coming in with the carburetor and everything. I was just messing around with it, but it wasn't going to the motor. And I couldn't figure out what's wrong, so I got to look in my mind, and there's this little solenoid valve on the bottom of the right lawnmower. It's got this little pin in there, magnetically operated. And when you turn it off, the magnet pulls the little pin up and stops the fuel from flowing. And when you turn the motor on, it energizes it and pulls the little spin back down and starts getting gas. Well, mine quit working. I ain't had on one. So I looked online and I found out how to fix it. You take the little thing off, you cut that little pin off, and you screw it back on. But you better put a cutoff valve in there to make sure it don't just keep running when you cut it off. But, you know, there's a lot of things we can access, but the problem is that may be something helpful, but there's so many avenues to sin. Hallelujah. And I've heard preachers preaching that, you know, no internet at all, don't do, you know, and I can see it to an extent. You know, people are preaching against televisions and all kind of stuff, and man, it's kind of useless when you're carrying it around in your pocket.
Uh-huh. That's right.
You know, some of them disfellowship Brother Price because he didn't just preach outright against internet, no internet, but some of these people were preaching, you know, to build a little room on the side of your house that you can only access by going outside and put your computer and internet out there so we can go ahead and say none of our people have internet in their homes.
Yeah.
Well, that's more dangerous than having it right in the middle of the living room.
Yeah.
Well, probably preach, if you're going to have it, just have it right there where anybody can walk up and see what you're doing.
Yeah.
You know? Preach guidelines, and they had a problem with that. Someone said something to him by the later. He said, you know, I'm all in on it if you want to go in on it. If you want me to preach against the internet, I'll do it just like everybody else does. But when you ask me to, I'm going to expect every one of you to get it out of your pocket.
Uh-huh.
Because it's the same thing.
Yeah.
Someone asked me about my cell phone. I was telling the guy down the store the other day, I said, you know, there's something wrong when a man's wife picks up his cell phone and he panics.
Uh-huh.
Right? I said, I don't panic when my wife picks up my cell phone. I might if my grandkids pick it up for a play with it. Because I don't know enough to fix it if something gets But I've told people before, it's laying around, you want to look at it? 111-959-11-1959. My birthday. You want to look at it? You can look at it. You can search through it, see if you want to. I keep it in check that way. My computer in there has got the same password. The computer at my house has the same password. You want to look at it? Look at it. Hallelujah. But we need to have guidelines.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We need to make sure we keep ourselves clean. We're entering an age of technology where, man, it's going to get far beyond just some little cell phone in your pocket. I'm telling you, things are going to get so far advanced that they're talking about now. They started all this artificial intelligence, and here I go rambling again, chasing rabbits. But, you know, they're talking about putting AI chips in our brain just to help us keep up with the artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence can learn in a year what it took man to figure out hundreds of years, thousands of years. It's dangerous.
Yes.
Even Elon Musk said, I fear that we're opening Pandora's box when we do it. Because they're having problems now with some of these artificial intelligence programs getting their feelings hurt and getting mad and saying and doing things that, you know, almost like human. They're getting hurt, getting mad. Well, what if they decide they want to take over and don't need us no more? They can repair themselves. They can produce anything we produce. You know, it can be bad, but I'm telling you, we can worry about a lot of things. We can worry about politics. We can worry about government. We can worry about who's going to be our next president. But it's like Jesus told the leaders of his day, he wasn't worried about who was in charge of politics. It made a lot of them mad. Now, that's not Bible. That's history. But you can read the statements that he made in the Bible and realize he wasn't worried about all those things people were worried about.
Yeah. Rendering the Caesar.
It just kind of blew their mind. But he's in control of it all. What's this world going to come to? Is it going to destroy itself? Are we going to be all blown up into space, you know, with nuclear weapons? It'd be. But what matters is, are we right with God?
That's it.
Are we on the right path?
Yeah.
Are we where we need to be on this road, living with God, on our walk with God? Hallelujah. That's what matters. I don't care what happens to this world. Our country alone could detonate all the nuclear weapons we've got right where they sit in the underground silos and turn this whole planet into rubble if they detonated them all at the same time. That's pretty scary. We've gotten to the point where we could just completely destroy ourselves. Hallelujah. But I want to stay on the right path.
Yes, sir.
This road has so many detours. Hallelujah. And without God, we're not going to know which way to go. You know? Well, how do we know how to stay on the right path? Well, Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 5, it said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not to thine own understanding. Well, Lord, this don't make sense to me. It doesn't matter. He's a lot smarter than we are. If he says we need to do it, do it. And all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So how do we know the right path? Well, I'll go back to the word of God again. Psalms 119 and 105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway. We simply need to study God's word and apply it to our lives if we want to stay on the right path. Jesus said again and again, they that obey my commandments, that keep my commandments, that obey the Father which is in heaven, hallelujah, those are the ones that are going to be saved. Turn to God. God's word not only allows us to see where we place our feet so we don't stumble. Hallelujah. Understanding God's word. It also allows us to see the path in life God wants us to take on our journey with him. Where are we going? What's my purpose in life? I don't know how many people have heard ask me that question. Folks, what are you in church? Hallelujah. You know what I tell them? For this is the whole duty of man. Serve God, keep his commandments. That's your purpose. Hallelujah. That's why you were here, to serve God. Hallelujah. To love him, to be part of the bride. Thank you, Jesus. Also, hallelujah. God's way is always the best. Isaiah 55 and 8. God said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. You know, compare an ant to ourselves, and that's not even close to how far God is past us. Hallelujah. Just think about it. God knows the future. He knows the end from the beginning. So we need to let him choose. David learned the hard way to let God choose. And I'm going through a few examples here in the Word of God. But God had declared that the children of Israel were not to be numbered. But why, Lord? Well, what's it matter if we decide to number them? What does it matter if you just obey God?
I see it, brother.
He has a reason. Does he need to tell you why? Job questioned God. Who are you to question me? I created you. If I want to stomp you out, and I'm putting in my own words, I can stomp you out. If I want to put you through this or that, I can do that. It's his privilege.
Yeah.
But nothing we can do about it. You know, ant running across the table and you decide it. He's got no say-so in the matter. You know what I'm saying? Neither do we. That's what God was trying to say. You don't got no say so in the matter. Who are you to question me? I know what's best.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, I love you, Jesus. But David chose to do it his own way. Told his generals, about number of children of Israel. They said, but, you know, David, God said for us not to do this. It wasn't like he didn't realize it. He told him to do it anyway. And you know the story how the angel with the drawn sword was there slaying the people. And David wound up by Nacon's threshing floor and making a sacrifice unto God. And, you know, getting the angel to stop. But David realized it's all his fault. He said, Lord, don't punish the people. I'm the one that did this. Hallelujah. You know, it's always dangerous when we decide to do it our own way. Especially when you know what God wants in the first place. You know? And here's the result of sin. Choosing your own way instead of God's way. 2 Samuel 24 and 13. Read verse 14 as well. So Gad came to David and told him and said unto him, Shall 7 years of famine come unto thee in thy land? This is punishment for him numbering the children of Israel. Or wilt thou flee 3 months before thine enemies while they pursue thee? Or that there be 3 days of pestilence in the land? Now advise and see what answer I shall return to him that sent me. And it sounds like David learned his lesson. And David said unto Gad, I am in a great strait. Let us fall now in the hand of the Lord, for his mercies are great. And let me not fall into the hand of man. Hallelujah. All right. This is what I choose. I want to do it your way, Lord, whatever you decide. You may think you're smart enough to choose the easiest route. You better leave it to God. Hallelujah. 2 Kings 22 and 2. And he, Solomon, said that which was right, or did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, and walked in all the ways of David his father, and turned not aside to the right hand or to the left. Hallelujah. Solomon walked in the ways of David his father. And you know what, church? We ought to be wise enough to walk in the ways of our fathers. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, you know, what he said, and we would be wise to walk, let me just back up a minute, we would be wise to walk in the way of David ourselves, that is, in the way of our father. But someone said, this is a good idea, walk in the ways of David. Hallelujah. Well, look at all the mistakes David made. That's what gives us hope. You know, David could be a man after God's own heart. After all his mistakes, we can't do church. The devil gets us down too easily because you messed up. There's no use. You can't do it. You can't live it. Yes, you can. But you messed up, yeah? And I'm going to do just like David did, and I'm going to run to God.
You're right.
Hallelujah. Yeah. That's what gives us hope.
That's right.
In the house of God, there's no unrepentable situations. I'm not talking about blasphemy and Holy Ghost. Well, there's nothing you can't go to God for.
Come on, brother.
I don't find anything in the Word of God. Nothing's too big for God. But you don't understand, man. I knew it was wrong. I read that verse of Scripture when I first got in church. Or if you sin willfully, Hebrews 10. 26, I believe it is. For if you sin willfully, after that you have received knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. And I thought, man, just the other day, I knew it was wrong. I've done it anyway. Lord, I'm lost. Now, if you read that whole chapter and put it together, he's talking about blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. He's not talking about just telling a lie when you knew you shouldn't have told a lie. Hallelujah. It talks about us not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as a manner of some is. Read the whole chapter. I got panicked about it. I thought it was over. I've been blaspheming the Holy Ghost. Now I can't be saved. Hallelujah. But we need to understand. David knew he wasn't supposed to number Israel. God forgave him. There's all kinds of accounts in the Bible about that. Hallelujah. There is no unrepentable situations in God's Word. No matter what we've done, no matter how bad we think it is, turning to God is the route we need to go. Be like Peter. Where can I go, Lord? You have the words of eternal life. I want to be saved, like Solomon. Let us walk in all the ways of our Heavenly Father, and turn not aside to the right or the left. Stay on the route, hallelujah, that God's directed us. We need to stay on that straight and narrow pathway called the highway of holiness. And too many people are straying off of it.
Mm-hmm.
For whatever reasons, for work, for relationships, for money, just for all kinds of different things. There should be nothing in our life that's more important than God. Isaiah 35 and 8 through verse 10. And the highway shall be there in a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. Well, you just don't want to read holiness. You know, it's sad. I read something just the other day from a sister that used to be in church. Says she still believes this message. She just can't live a Pentecostal lifestyle. That's sad, man. You don't really even understand what holiness is about. I used to think, man, if you could help people understand, you know, logically that there's only one person in the Godhead, that there's only one method of baptism, that it'd be, you know, enough to keep them, but it's not. You got to have it in your heart.
That's right, bro.
To follow this path that God set you on.
Yeah, made up mind.
You got to have that made up mind, brother.
That's right.
Hallelujah. It bothers me when I see people that have been in church for years and then all of a sudden they just, what's the use? There's a lot of use. There's a lot of people watching you. You have a family. Hallelujah. I want to see souls saved. Hallelujah. But the way of holiness, the unclean shall not pass over it. Nothing unclean is going to enter into heaven. But it shall be for those, the wayfaring man, though few fools shall err, shall not err therein. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. That doesn't mean they're not going to enter in. They're really going to get in there by error. Hallelujah. They're not going to be allowed there. There's no way they're getting in. In other words, verse 9 says, no lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereon. It shall be found there. But the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransom, you know what the word ransom means? I was ransomed from this life of sin. Hallelujah. And the ransom of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy, gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall be away. Hallelujah. I'm going to make it, church. Matthew 7 and 13, and I don't lack a whole lot here. Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. That lets us know that the majority aren't making it. The majority of the religious world, I'm not talking about just apostolics, I hate to know the percentage of folks that are supposed to be in the truth, but the majority of the world that calls themselves Christians aren't making it. The majority of the world is teaching a Trinitarian form of doctrine, and that's not right. Hallelujah. Proverbs 3 and 16. Again, I've read this. But in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path.
That's right.
He'll keep you. If you'll keep him, hallelujah, where he needs to be in our life. So tonight I ask again, what direction is your life headed? Your way or God's? Hallelujah. This ain't Burger King, church. Too many people feel like, I want it my way. It don't happen that way.
Right.
You know, if you go to Burger King, you don't always get it your way either, do we? We went on a trip trying to get there and get something to eat while we were on a trip. Boy, it was a nightmare. Did you get everything right? I didn't care. I've got something to eat. I'm just going to eat it. Hallelujah. I'm just glad I'm not picky because some people can't do that. Stand with me. Hallelujah. But I want us to think about that this evening. Am I on the route God wants me to be on? That's fine, sure. my life going the way God wants it to go? Or am I struggling with God trying to make it go the way I want to go? Hallelujah. Lord, help me to be sensitive enough in the spirit to realize the direction you want me to take. Please, God. Hallelujah. Is there any other announcements? Well, I've got a confession to make. I think the pastor's going to see now. Before I left on my trip, I got someone to preach on 50 Sunday service. Remember who I got to preach it. And I'm wondering now if I really did get somebody, and should I go ahead and get somebody else and wind up two preachers showing up here? Or winding up with our fifth Sunday service and having nobody show up? Oh, Lord, help us.
Somebody can preach.
I did it before we went on that trip and all kind of stuff going on. I just forgot. I mean, Bob did not ask somebody. I thought I asked Gabriel Reynolds. Sister Felicia texted him and asked him about it. He said, no, he couldn't preach it on that day. He was tied up. Might be here all wrong.
Oh, he'll be in South Dakota.
Okay. But anyway, be praying about it. Also, another thing, I'm wanting to try to do an outreach. And Brother Grady keeps talking about he might come with us and set up an outreach so something gets the whole church involved. But I want to make sure when I do it that it's not some time when nobody's going to be here. You know? So I want to try to plan it in advance. He just got back out of hospital just the other day, so I think it will be tomorrow. But anyway, I want to try to be in prayer about this because I want to see some kind of outreach here. I want to see souls saved.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God. He's had success in different churches doing it, so maybe the Lord will smile on us and let us have.